consulted with Vice President Biden on the Cancer Moonshot Initiative. Apart from her scientific accomplishments, she's a true Renaissance woman, a dedicated reader of Urdu literature, co-author of Ghalib, Epistemologies and Elegance. She founded Urdu Mehfil, hosting writers such as Ahmed Faraz, John Elia, and Salman Rushdie. A strong supporter of girls' education, she has personally established a scholarship for top-performing girls at her alma mater, FC College of Girls in Islamabad. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Dr. Azma. We told her this pretty much summarizes the state of girls all over the world. They can't read, they can't write, and they're not allowed to have a voice. I'm a scientist, but we called my mother a rocket scientist. Her life epitomized the prevailing ethos and traditions of a Sharif Zadi being raised in the Aligarh in the 1930s, where high culture was defined by an attitude of extreme gentleness, particularly in the men. Overt hyper-masculinity was overt vulgarity. Sadly, it was also a time when older women in the family had to smuggle a female tutor to enter the Zanankhana secretly to teach the young girls how to read and write. Because basically my very gentle and very civilized grandfather's attitude was, why should we teach the girls to read and write so they can go out and shake the hands of Englishmen? After the death of the family patriarch, as the British tightened their hold over the natives, my mother's family suddenly found themselves bereft of their possessions with no practical skills to survive. And for my mother, this traumatic experience underscored the importance of education as the only means for individual empowerment, and thus ignited in her an intense desire to educate not only her children, especially the girls, but all the children in the community. I remember one night, earlier this year, I was telling some friends about my mother, about her desire to teach everyone around her to read and write, so much so, and she did this with everyone, so much so that our driver not only learned how to read and write and started reading the daily jhang regularly, he ended up writing his autobiography. When I told this episode to my friends, one of my very famous unnamed writer friends immediately said, "Well, Azra, what do you expect a driver to write but an autobiography?" And now he said, "I have the name of his next book, Bus." This is why we call my mother a rocket scientist. Because you see, teaching someone to read is rocket science. She and the pioneering women of her generation are the ones who truly deserve today's honor. I am here because of those women. So I would like to accept this honor on behalf of all those pioneering women of my mother's generation. Education became my mother's lifelong passion, and once you find a passion like my mother or our driver did, then nazare ko to jumbishe mishgaan bhi paar hai. Nazare ko to jumbishe mishgaan bhi paar hai. Even the blinking of the eyelash is unwelcome when the sight is fixated upon the object of desire. Nazare ko to jumbishe mishgaan bhi paar hai. Nargis ki aankh se tujhe dekha kare koi. With the eye of the flower, narcissist should one see you. Today we are living in anxiety-ridden, Islamophobic, immigrant-weary, uncertain, unpredictable, dangerous and very, very unstable times. The world seems to be hurling itself towards entropy. Questions at the heart of the human condition which we thought were settled centuries ago. Issues as fundamental as facts matter, truth is important, respect for each other is at the core of human values. These are being challenged. The worst thing for me to see is that we have lost an essential optimism about the future. And everybody has their own pet apocalyptic forecast for a gloomy future. Well, I'm here to say otherwise. Let us use this volatile situation as a transformative moment, a wake-up call, an opportunity to re-examine our situation. Because remember, a foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds. The challenge facing us today is this: how do we reconcile our Stone Age Paleolithic emotions and our medieval institutions with the godlike technology of cutting and pasting the human genome and nuclear weapons that we have developed? In this question lies the existential threat that is facing us. We are afraid, we are apprehensive, we don't know what to expect. Well, my answer starts with a great book of fiction. There's a very beautiful anecdote in Don Quixote where a young boy is punished by being told to go to prison to sleep off his cheekiness. The lad replies that he can be sent to prison and put in chains, but no one has the power to make him sleep, because staying awake or not is his decision. Indeed, of all the greatness we aspire to, by far, freedom is the greatest. Freedom gives us a choice. At every step we take in our life, we can have a choice. Today, we can choose to succumb to despair and cynicism, but losing heart is the most dangerous thing. Or we can decide that we will overcome. My friends, the first step out of this imbroglio is to stop empowering our leaders and start empowering ourselves. Education is the essential first step towards this empowerment. Empowerment of individuals is possible, as proved by this diverse set of people in the room. Muslims, Christians, Jews, above all, I'm deeply moved by the support of our Indian friends. Even as our two countries may be at daggers drawn, benefactors like Asha Motwani, Eli and Dinesh Paliwal, Ruchira Gupta, so many others defy the leaders who are telling them to boycott everything Pakistani. Instead of empowering the leaders, they are here to empower the little girls in Pakistan through education. Bravo to all. for that matter, higher education, enough. From the 1930s of my mother's days in Aligarh to the present generation of Sheherzad growing up in New York, we have come a long way. But sadly, acquiring education has not proved to be enough, and I want to take you one step further and define how these very gains have paved the way for next generation of enslavements. Being a scientist, I'm going to illustrate the situation with a simple example from evolutionary biology. With few exceptions, humans are the only animal species where the female prettiest herself. It's the women who are trying to look beautiful. Take the classic example of the peacock. It has a staggeringly ornamental tail, which can be a handicap when it comes to combat. But it's essential because with that flamboyant, glitzy, showy, decorative tail, the male peacock is asking for the hand of the peahen by transmitting a message of strong genes. In all other animals, the choice of the mate rests with the female. Aesthetic beauty, by declaring freedom from disease, serves as a potential indicator for healthy offspring. The peahen will choose the peacock with the most ornate tail. What about men? Well, there really are only three categories of men: the handsome, the rich, and the great majority. The handsome don't need much else. The rich possess the ultimate aphrodisiac for women, resources that guarantee the survival of her children. But in order to appear attractive, the great majority have had to substitute natural attributes with acquired skills. Displays of intellect, like being a professional, a lawyer, a doctor, a scientist, engineer, abstract talents like music, poetry, philosophy, art. Selfishly, men have monopolized these areas by disenfranchising half the human race from even having the opportunity to acquire the skills until recently, forcing women to be judged solely on the basis of their natural beauty, and even that beauty as defined by the male. Another form of enslavement is envy, the driving spirit of our society, where the pursuit of acquisitions is motivated not by real need, but by a desire to appear better than others. So here's the rub. If men and women acquire the same skills, and women finally start getting equal pay, and don't necessarily seek resources in a mate, while men are forced to look beyond a woman's body, then what should we find attractive about each other? That our partner has a bigger house or a bigger heart? That they give more lavish parties or show their deep love for us through friendship? That they relish their bank accounts or their books? When I arrived in America at 23 years of age as an immigrant, I found a warm and welcoming home here. For the first time, I understood the meaning of what Immanuel Kant said. Hospitality means the right of a stranger not to be treated as a stranger. And it is because of this spirit of hospitality in America that I can say to Sheherzad and to the younger generation gathered in this room today, do not give in to the darkness being forecast in your future. Instead, live up to the uniquely generous spirit of your country. Be aware that in this theater of life, it is reserved only for God and for angels to be the lookers on. The rest of us have to work. It is essential for you to make sure that if you do not entirely waste your education, make sure that others are educated, and that all of us, men and women, forcefully reject this second enslavement of competition and envy that has crept upon us. One of my favorite writers is Annie Dillard, who got her Pulitzer Prize for her book Pilgrim at Tinker Creek in 1976. I was listening to her the other day on NPR, and Melissa Block, who was interviewing her, asked her, "Miss Dillard, how did you choose the title of your new book, The Abundance?"
Ms. Dillard responded that over the last few decades, she's been collecting interesting quotations in her journal. And there's a line in the Quran which she found particularly beautiful and which forms the basis of the title. They will question thee concerning what they should expend. Here the word is not spend, expend, what can you do without? They will question thee, what should they expend? Say the abundance, give it all away. If you spend, you will fill up from behind, empty it. The reference here is not just to money and material goods, but the real appeal is for you to give of yourself. You have already given money to Dil. Now what about investing your time in helping Shaila and Fizza, Amara and Fazle with your time? Develop a capacious self and visit one of Dil's schools on your next trip back home. Spend a few hours with those young schoolgirls in remote villages. Give them hope. Bring a smile to their faces as they remain shackled in horrifying social chains. Labor to be more compassionate. Offer the exiled a home, the abundance. Give with abundance. Refuse the yoke of material success. Choose the higher ethical values of empathy, compassion, generosity, altruism, and love. We cannot risk having another person come this close to blowing up our world and our core values, our dignity and our self-respect. I say to you that the time has come for you to reject all ugliness and only strive for beauty. Use your intelligence, your talents, your singular status, your influence, your positions of privilege to once and for all shatter these artificial borders and finally enable each person to be able to say, I can read, I can write, I can talk, I have a voice. Listen to Shaila's Dil, listen to your Dil. And if your Dil tells you one thing and your mind tells you another, then please listen to Khumar Sahab who says, Aplo dil apni apni kahe jab khumar. When the heart and mind tell you two opposing things, Aplo dil apni apni kahe jab khumar, akal ki suniye, dil ka kaha kijiye. Listen to the mind but do what your heart tells you. What should you expend? Spend it all. And if others try to scare you, then listen to Fahmida Riaz with which I will end. Kuch log tumhe samjhayenge, wo tumko khauf dilayenge. Jo hai wo bhi kho sakta hai. Is raah mein rehsan hai itne, kuch aur yahan ho sakta hai. Kuch aur to aksar hota hai. Par tum jis lamhe mein zinda ho, ye lamha tumse zinda hai. Ye waqt nahi phir aayega. Tum apni karni kar guzro. जो होगा देखा
Ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy your